Now, here comes the music.
Since November 2nd, 1952, WGRN has been pumping the airwaves with music. College radio is notorious for not having a quality feel or a large audience base. But why is that? Did WGRN rise above that?
Roundtable, pop concert, sports news, Journey into Melody, campus chatter, still waters. Again, this year, WGRN, the campus radio station, built in 1952, was on the air, bringing programs produced by GC students to both campus and community. Between Thanksgiving and Christmas, the transmitter and control panel were rebuilt. Not only was the power increased, but a new type of broadcasting was inaugurated to enable the broadcast to be heard all over Greenville.
I started working here my sophomore year of college. I actually came in as a music major because we had a CCM major is what it was. Just kind of all in one. And I wanted to do that, but I wasn't a musician, so I came in as that, but that unraveled pretty quick. I was already working at WGEL, which is the radio station uptown here. I worked there since I was a senior in high school, so radio was what I wanted to do. I wanted to have that music experience, but wanted to do radio as a job. But I was already, into my freshman year, I switched over to a mass comm major. I still hadn't started working at the station, just because, like I said, I was doing it, you know, every day for a part-time job uptown. And a buddy asked me if I wanted to do a show with him on GRN. So I did that my sophomore year, and then junior and senior year, I did my own show both years. I was the news director 1 year and a sports director 1 year.
I started off, my major was mass comm, so I started off, I had simple classes, some of which on-air time, just covering shifts as a DJ for a normal format, which actually switched a couple different times during my five years at GC. So, and then also I was a music manager for a while. So just whenever stuff, or I guess it was more programming, just stuff would come in and you would kind of have to schedule and, you know, stuff like that. So that was also part of not really an internship. It ended up being coursework. You turned in what you did. So it's a learning environment, student run. So you know, basically a lab. Everything you did there was part of your class. There were some DJs that just volunteered, just to DJ that weren't, you know, but and then I also after a while had my own show there in the evening from 10 to midnight. Don't even remember what night. It was a metal, Christian metal, and
so I was sitting at the DC one day eating dinner, and a friend of mine, Danielle, I forget her last name. Are you going to record this exactly the way I'm saying it? Okay. I'm going to start over now. Start it again. I'm ready now. So I was sitting at the DC one day, and a friend of mine, Danielle, was just talking about how she works at the radio station. She was telling us about Ryan Mifflin and kind of the stuff he's been doing, and it sounded pretty cool. Me and my friend Nathan were sitting with her at the table, and she was talking how she does a show, and then me and Nathan just started coming up with, like, ridiculous, silly ideas for, like, what we could do for a radio show, right? And we're spitballing, like, names and, like, weird bits and stuff we could do on the radio. That's kind of when we realized, oh, hey, we might actually have something here. So we contacted Ryan, got in touch with him, and then he basically helped us set up the show, the Nate and Cam show, last semester. And that's what we did.
The whole show is pretty much the Seinfeld of radio, says Nathan Craig, one half of the two-man radio hosting team. It's a show about nothing.
Oh, I just remember it being... Before I started working here again, I remember that just being the most fun I've ever had in radio. And that's really just what college radio is supposed to be, you know? Because I always say you don't have to answer to anybody, but you always have to answer to somebody. At minimum, there's always the FCC, and there's always the professor, you know, who's ever in charge, but you don't have, you know... And a radio station I worked at in St. Louis was owned by Clear Channel, and they own half the stations in the country, and they own half the TV stations in the country, and half the billboards in the country, half the live venues in the country. So, you know, in that situation, you got people making these policies that affect hundreds and hundreds of radio stations, you know. You lose all the individuality. But in college radio, you don't have to be doing that. And you're just, you know, doing your thing and trying to come up with something cool. And it's just, you know, really pure. And you just, you know, you can do a lot of dumb stuff, but you can do a lot of cool stuff and just have a lot of fun that you just won't be able to have outside of that setting. So that's the thing I really remember from those days. Just having free rein and being able to just try all kinds of stuff. Yeah, it was kind of, it was pretty informal. There wasn't a student leadership team. If there was, they weren't really actively doing things and managing things. Ryan Mifflin was pretty much the station manager. He's in charge of the whole kick and caboodle. There were different people who could do different shows scheduled throughout the week. But other than that, the rest of the role was pretty hazy. And that was kind of by design. We wanted to be... set up in such a way that you could do as much or as little as you wanted for the radio station, since it was a volunteer position. So we didn't want to make it so you had to do a certain number of things. Ryan kind of tried that at first and said it wasn't very successful. He'd rather just allow people to do whatever they wanted. And that worked out pretty well so far. So that's kind of how it started.
You know, it was a very... interesting mix. Being a Christian college campus that they played mainly Christian music, but you had a student populace that didn't listen to a lot of, as a whole, you know, when polled, didn't listen to Christian music. I mean, there were some that did, but then, you know, so they struggled to adapt.
So we're actually... out of that flavor, any other flavors you want?
What did you even get? I mean, come on. They struggled to adapt to a kind of what people on campus wanted to hear, and they maintained programming like Our Daily Bread and Focus on the Family and programs like that that were taped source or satellite. After a while, my first year, they were still playing music off of cassette, teaching students how to cue cassettes. They still had records too. And this was 92, you know, so it was still, you know, my first year, none of my years, the radio station isn't where it is now, isn't when it was where the black room, I guess, is now, was the communications building. So a lot smaller studio. Actually, when I was there, it was new because they remodeled the whole studio right before I came in. I'm from Greenville, so I kind of hung out there a little bit in high school. So, because I happened to listen to a metal show that another guy had done, so I kind of got to see that kind of change. So that remodel was really cool. Some of the more modern stuff that they did. You know, they moved into more CD format, so obviously it's a lot easier. I think now they have a lot of stuff on computer, you know. That's just the way most radio stations have gone. But, you know, sometimes it is hard for them to cover shifts. And, I mean, you had students, it's class, you know. You had blocks of time that's there. There's, like, couldn't get people. They came up with this idea to use a VHS tape, which could be 8 hours, 6 hours long, whatever, and we would go in and record a non-time specific shift with no mention of anything, you know, kind of current or anything, you know, just the music and the station IDs and things like that that could be played anytime. And sometimes they just have people go in and put that in for a block of time where they couldn't find people to fill a shift.
No, not really. The thing that is different between then and now, looking at the situation the way we have it now, and I want to be careful. I don't want anything to sound disparaging in any way. It's not that things are better, it's that things are different. But you asked if there were any problems with that way. The only thing would be was it was structured to where there was a student management team. So there was Professor Holman, who was the general manager, operations manager, or whatever his official title was, and then you had a student manager under him who kind of oversaw the student leadership team, and each of them kind of did, you know, they did what they did. And I mean, you had a sports director and a news director, music director, that kind of stuff. And then you had the staff under them. It was up to the students to make that stuff happen. And if it didn't, it just didn't. And if it didn't, that would reflect in their grades and stuff. But that's the only thing I would see as a problem. If somebody wasn't reliable, it's a different situation from a regular radio station where you can say, you know, you've been warned, you know, you've got to do this, and I'm not going to say you should fire people. It's just left everything up to the students. Whereas now, one of the things I love about the way it is now is there's not the same kind of structure to it anymore. It's more like a club, and the people that are there really want to be there. And we do have a couple students who we've worked it out to where they can get some credit for things, but, and like I said, anyone who's there, they're there because they want to be, and they wanted to be before too, but you know what I'm saying, it's a fun thing, and I kind of took the role of what the student manager would have done before. I work with individual students, and it's not just one person doing a sports director job. It's like six or seven making a sports committee, and you know, we kind of assign things out like this, so everybody has like a really specific job, not like kind of, you know, a department does. That makes sense. There seems to be just more follow through. I think like the product we end with is, in some cases, better.
Under the direction of Professor Lothers, the WGRN staff operates and maintains the station. Added to the radio program this year was the installation of a new console controls unit. The station broadcasts are produced 4 days a week.
From the time Ryan and Dad were here as students back in the 90s, WGRN has seen many equipment and content changes as technology has moved forward and students have deviated away from the primarily worship-based tunes played by the WGRN of old. But a station that's produced by an institution with such strong religious ties is sure to encounter some obstacles coming to terms with the ideal versus the popular. Right?
They started adding mainstream music that wasn't Christian music, and it was a big, it was kind of a dilemma for what music do you include? Positive message, mainstream music? Do you include an artist that may or may not have a lifestyle? That was a big question, debate. Do you play something from, Madonna or Elton John or, do you support that certain things? And so basically you were left with a lot of, you just picked and choosed out of your top 40, like, okay, you have, we're not playing everything that a normal top 40 would play, and then we're playing this other mix of stuff for a while. They were throwing on some oldies in the mix, so it was just very strange format for a while.
Sure, I think what was best about the old station is still what is best about this station, and that is it's college radio, and that is by definition, it's supposed to be fun. It's supposed to be weird, it's supposed to be free format, and it's crazy, and it's still is that. I think what's better about that station is that it's still the same situation, it's just more organized. And again, I want to make sure that nothing when I compare old to new ever comes off as negative, because it's not a judgmental negative thing. It's not that it was bad and it's good. My predecessor, he had a full course load of classes to teach. And like I said, the way it was structured is there was a student leadership team and it was like, all right, you guys go do this. And he oversaw that. Whereas when they brought me in, I was like, I'm going to run this like I was running any other station. I'm going to do this and that, and this is how I'm going to set it up. And the students, one of the first organizational changes was the students came up with a block format for our music. It used to be, that's a huge difference. I hear that all the time. It used to be we'd just play anything, anytime. I'm sure your dad probably commented on that, and when your dad and I were here, we're still live DJs most of the time, so we did have a system. You're supposed to play an oldie, and then a new one, and then a this, and then a Christian song, and then a that, and then whatever. And there was a bit of structure to it. But in more recent years, I remember going up there one time to do my show, and I literally heard a ZZ Top song followed by the Super Mario Brothers theme song, followed by some kind of Christian, contemporary song.
I'm ready.
He said, come to the table.
There were some, but I think that what people probably tuned into was the programming and focus on the family, our daily bread, or the church services that, Sunday morning they would broadcast. First Baptist Church for a while. There was another church that we broadcasted from, they would cover college sports, so, people would be tuned into that, I'm sure, more the college related community, the family, friends, because there always have been somewhat of a division college community. And, it's just, I grew up here. It just is. So there's some town people that are like,
I don't really need to have anything to do with, you know? They'll listen to WGEL, but you know, you probably got your older people who probably listen to your Bible-based shows, like the Our Daily Bread stuff, and things like that.
No, there's always that kind of notion in college radio, like, you know, nobody's listening. It's just, you know, it's a small radio station, and, you know, especially in the early days when, you know, before when we started streaming on the webs, which obviously opened up a whole big, much wider audience. But in early days, they were pretty much just broadcasting to Bond County, and I don't know prior to my time here that there was much listening in the community interests. And I don't know outside of the times when we were doing our shows, when we had friends listening and we were doing stuff like that, kind of drew people in. I don't know how much of a campus listenership that was or wasn't. I don't really have a good sense for that. I've noticed that we've gotten a lot more community involvement, especially in terms of sponsors. So, this semester we had a lot of students who really wanted to go out and find sponsors for WGRN, which is awesome. So we have, a lot more, business supporting us, like local businesses. And that's great for us because, it means that we get, a little bit more funding to plan events and purchase equipment that we need stuff like, that it also means that those companies oftentimes play us on their speakers at their work. So now we have a lot more people listening to WGRN, which is great. So I'd say that probably the most exciting thing for me. We also get a lot of fan letters, usually from the prison, which is pretty cool, I think, because it means we have a lot of people listening, stuff like that. Yeah, I think the majority of our listenership actually comes from the Greenville community. Not necessarily from students, because there's only 1,000 students on campus, but there's probably 12,000, 13,000 within range of our antenna, probably more than that, honestly. I don't know what the exact range of it, but so we do get a lot of listeners, especially in the prison, because they got a lot of time to listen. But yeah, I think it's really big.
You know, things that were back and forth in the management and, were, you know, what music we should play, there was polls and questionnaires sent out to the students. Do we play what, you know, obviously you listen to what people are playing from their dorm rooms. It wasn't WGRN, you know. But then, you know, you can't play everything, and that was their slogan for a while, WGRN, the best of everything. You can't do that. I mean, you know, there were some radio stations that were weird, like they'll play one song after another, and it'll be like, okay, that's kind of a weird combination, but they were really stretching to play it, a Christian hit radio song and then like an oldie song. It was a very weird mix. I always thought that we should just kind of focus, maybe, pick a demographic and go for that, you know? But they were, it was a really collective, I guess, you know, in the format itself. And it, obviously the students produce shows, but that was a break from format, like I said. So that's fine if it was different. That was 2 hours or an hour, whatever, of focused thing. It could be, you know, all oldies, all metal or whatever, so that somebody that wanted to hear that obviously would hopefully tune into that time, you know?
The finger that turns the dial rules the air, especially around WGRN land. An entirely new programming format presented The Sound is Round this year with emphasis on campus news and views and mood music to study by.
Yeah, I think it's a great radio station. Even listening recently, I've noticed the stingers and sort of branding that we put in there is really high quality and sounds like an actual radio station. Like when I listen, they just recently started playing WGRN in the DC. Oh, I'm sorry, in the Union downstairs. So listening down there, it sounds like a normal radio station now, which is pretty cool considering a few years ago it was just a computer that played music in a closet somewhere. We never really had a legit setup until Ryan took over.
The station has changed, altered, and become something completely different than what was originally intended. But in spite of all the changes that have occurred in its 66-year history, at its heart, WGRN is still what college radio is meant to be. Fun, lively, and a great way for students to get some practical experience with an output that we interact with every day, even if we don't always realize it. So has WGRN risen above that? Well, we feel the proof is in the pudding.
For the friendly voice of radio, the people's choice. Music, weather, sports, and news, it's radio. The people choose. Everybody swinging to the swinging voice of radio, the people's choice. Big fry, small fry, dawn to dawn, it's radio that turns them on.
I had friends. You might not be able to use this, though, but you'll enjoy it. Apparently there was a streaking incident on campus, and it was covered by a few of the DJs. It was newsworthy, so they were talking about it on air, and they were called into Professor Holman's office, and I wasn't actually a part of this. This was the year before I started doing... I took a year, I was a freshman there, and I didn't do any comm. I was an undecided major, and I didn't do any comm courses, so the next year, it was either the second semester or the second year that I started doing DJing and stuff, but they were brought in the office, and Carrie was like, what were you guys thinking? And one of them was like, about what? So, yeah, I think it was across Scott Field.
The story that always comes to mind is your dad. We were doing my show one time, and the way the studio used to be, we used to be in the black room. We were in the far end of the black room. I don't even know what's in that part of the building now. That's where our studio was in this space. We had a production room and the on-air studio, and they faced each other. There was a glass window in between them, so you could see what was going on from there to there. I just remember one time we were playing a Britney Spears song.
Oh, no.
And he got up on the counter and did a Britney Spears... You know, tied his shirt up high and did a Britney Spears dance. And he was trying to mess us up while we were talking, you know. But that's always... I can't get that out of my head.
I can't blame you with that. I can't get that out of my head either.
Yeah, it's going to be the whole thing now. I'm going to have trouble sleeping now. But there's no punchline to that story other than his dad lifted his shirt and did a Britney Spears dance.
I think I did it again. I made you believe we're more than just friends.
This town's so lame, I'm feeling so wired. It's 4 a.m., I'm not even tired. We're in your car, we can drive away. Oh yeah, yeah. We're almost there, I'm loving this feeling of something new. Just right what I needed, take me there. We can drive away.
You're listening to WGRN 89.5, Greenville, Illinois.